to the Cerberus saga, another episode. The breadboard prototype has grown quite a bit from last time. The new part is here. I've basically now integrated the 6502 CPU. Actually, this is a W65C02S. It's a CMOS static core modern version of the old 6502. It has some instructions that the old CPU also didn't have. For instance, it has a wait for interrupt instruction, which saves a lot of power. It has a stop instruction, things that the old cores didn't have because they were not static. So they always needed the clock to be running at a certain minimum speed to keep the values of the internal registers refreshed. But this is a fully static core. You can withdraw the clock, you can stop the processor, and the internal registers will preserve their state. So I'm making use of it. I'm using, for instance, I will explain all this soon, but just to give you a preview, I'm using a mode when the CPU is not engaged. I withdraw, I not only put it in standby mode, I withdraw the clock as well. And if I restart then the CPU from where I stopped it, it will continue as if it hadn't been stopped. And this is very important for keyboard input, as I'm going to explain to you. Basically, the keyboard input is a non-maskable interrupt, so it will stop the processor, so CAT, the I/O controller, can access the memories to store the value of the key that was pressed, and then it releases the CPU again. So it's important that this is a static core. These things we've seen before, that's the buzzer for sound, that's the PS2 keyboard input that goes into CAT, and that's the micro SD drive that works as a kind of hard disk drive for the system. Now, the 6502 is here. This cable is here. This first cable is a data bus, and it connects to the data bus here, which originally comes from there. So the address bus and the data bus, they are repeated on both sides of the board. It's a very long cable, but it connects nicely with the data bus. And now this other flat cable here connects to the address bus from bits 0 to 15 and data bus bits 0 to 7 going from my left to my right this way. Now, there are important control signals of the CPU, all of which have a pull-up resistor. They are all pulled up. And the reason is we cannot leave these control signals undefined. This is particularly important in a multiprocessor system like Cerberus, where your attention may go somewhere else where the action is happening, but you have to make sure that all the processors, in this case these two, there will be a third one coming, they are in a defined known state. So they can be halted, they can be allowed to continue after being halted, or they can be stopped altogether, reset. You need to know that. So these signals here, if I remember where they are, this is the RDY signal, or ready. When this signal is pulled low, the 6502 will halt. Then we have this one here, which is the non-maskable interrupt. When it's pulled low, the processor will stop doing whatever it's doing, and it will serve the interrupt. In this case, the interrupt is a key press. The way it's working is that when I press on a key, the keyboard will interrupt CAT, which is the I/O controller. And then CAT will halt the CPU by pulling the ready signal low and withdrawing the clock, and also putting the buses in a high impedance state, which is achieved through this signal here, the bus enable, which is also pulled up. But CAT, through this wire here, can pull this signal down, which will put the address, control, and read-write buses in a high impedance state. And then CAT will put the ASCII value of the key pressed into the low memory here in an address called, that I'm calling the mailbox. It's hexadecimal 200, which is, you know, just a position 513. We have to leave the first half K free, because the 6502 has the so-called page zero in there. It puts the stack in those initial addresses. So those are reserved. The mailbox is the one byte that comes immediately after that at address 513 or hexadecimal 200. So CAT will put the key value here while the CPU is halted. Then once CAT has put the message in the mailbox, it will release the CPU. The CPU will start processing again. And then very shortly afterwards, cat will pull down the non-maskable interrupt signal, which basically would tell the CPU, okay, now stop what you're doing, because you have a message in the mailbox. Go there in the mailbox, load the contents of address hexadecimal 200, because it contains a key that has been pressed.
Let's go over this again, because I made it sound complicated, while in fact it isn't. Here's what's going on. After cat has received the key press from the keyboard, what it will do is, through spacer, cat always talks to the other system components through spacer, it will pull these signals down on the 6502. It will pull the ready signal, or RDUI, down, telling the processor to halt, to not do anything. It will also pull the bus enable signal down, so the 6502 tri-states its data and address buses, and the RWB bus as well, this signal here. It will tri-state these signals to a high impedance state. It will be as if the 6502 weren't connected to the system. And finally, cat through spacer will also withdraw the clock, which is redundant with pulling RDUI down, but hey, I have the pins. So it will really halt the 6502 and put its buses in a high impedance state, because that's what it needs for the next step, which is, now cat through spacer wants to access those buses in order to put the ASCII value of the key pressed in the mailbox, which is address hexadecimal 200. Once it has done that, then it doesn't need to use the buses anymore. So again, through spacer, cat will pull those signals back up. So the ready signal will go back up, so the 6502 will unhalt itself, the clock will return, and the bus enable signal will be high, so the buses will be enabled again, so the 6502 will have access to the memories once again. Now, once that is done, cat will again, through spacer, send the signal through this control signal nexus we have, which is spacer. Spacer is not really a control bus, it's a huge control multiplexer. We have the pins, we have the logic for that, so that's the best, cleanest way to do it, so that's how I'm doing it. So through spacer, cat will pull the non-maskable interrupt signal down, telling the 6502, there is something waiting for you in the mailbox, so go there and have a look, please. And then that's exactly what the 6502 will do. It will go check the mailbox and load whatever ASCII signal is there into its data buses. And now finally the 6502 is running and it knows what key was pressed. That's it. It's not that complicated, is it?
So this is the way it's doing. It's working. It's all memory mapped communication, because cat is capable of DMA, direct memory access. So all the communication will happen through the mailbox, which is one little address in the low memory, and through a series of two interrupts. First, cat is interrupted by the keyboard, then cat puts the message in the mailbox and interrupts the CPU, which then goes and reads the message. It sounds complicated, but it's actually very simple. I'll show you the code, the programming of all this later in this video. It's quite simple, and if it sounds like it's going to take a lot of time to react to one key press, think again. This all happens pretty instantaneously. The CPUs are now running at 4 megahertz. I removed the option for changing the clock speed, and the reason is I made some pins available on cat. It reduced the complexity of spacer, which is already complex enough, and the original motivation was to run legacy code, the old games, which would run too fast in Cerberus compared to the ZX81 or the TRS-80, so fast that they could become unplayable. So that's why I had the option to push the clock speed down to 1 megahertz. But now, since I explained in a previous episode that I'm focusing on the main goal, which is to provide a didactical platform, and I'm giving up backward binary compatibility because it would just destroy the elegance of this architecture, there is no reason anymore to offer this option for a lower clock speed. So I'm by default running the 6502 always at 4 megahertz. It can run faster, There are different versions that you can buy also of the Z80. Some can go to 10 megahertz, but 4 megahertz is more than enough for the objectives of this platform. So the CPUs will be running at 4 and CAT runs at 16 megahertz. Oh, I just removed something by mistake here, which is pretty bad. I have to check again where that cable is going. And that brings me to the next subject. As you will see, the CPU is working, but it's not completely stable. Sometimes there are spurious memory writes. There is a write that shouldn't be there. And it has to, this lack of stability has to do with this mess here. All these long cables, these long wires. Look at this path here for the data bus. It goes from here to there, from there to there, and then from there to the video memory. There is a lot of parasitic capacitance here. So I'm glad that the CPU is working stably enough for me to be able to prove to myself that the logic and the kernel code are working. It's working stable enough to provide me with that evidence, which is all I wanted. But we cannot really go further with this board. I was hoping that maybe I could wire up the Z80 as well and do the same thing I did for the 6502 with the Z80 to increase my confidence. But it's hopeless, because even if I'm not using the Z80, the fact that the wires will be connected will already increase the parasitic capacitances and inductances and resistances even more, and the whole thing will become so unstable that it will not prove anything. If it's not working, I will not know whether it's because I made a mistake or just the parasitics are screwing up with the whole thing. So I will move from this to the PCB. That will be the next step. Either a PCB only for this part, reusing this, or I will run the risk and already make a complete PCB for the whole system. I still have to think about that, see how I'll be feeling about that in the next few days. But in the meantime, as I explained in a previous episode, I don't have a schematic. when you're working for a company as an engineer, you have to document every step you make. So you always have a schematic that you keep up to date. But this is a hobby, and I didn't want to be hampered by having to keep a schematic up to date. So I didn't even make one. I'm building this here over the board, off the top of my head. The only documentation I have is the hardware description of the four custom chips, CAT, Spacer, Skunk, and Caviar. I have the hardware description and the kernel code for all four of them, so that's the only documentation I have. So when I pull a wire out by mistake like this, I have to be very careful and trace back where that wire should be going, because the board itself is the only documentation of how the system is wired together. I don't have a schematic, so I think it's time now. The complexity is now big enough that I should document what is on this board before a cat comes here and destroys everything, and then I don't know anymore what I did. I can, of course, retrace it, but it could take a lot of time and effort that I don't want to spend. So the next step will be the board. Is there something? Oh, there's one more thing I want to say. The increased number of wires that you see here coming from spacer to the two memories and the CPU, the reason for that is the following. I was using a read-write bus before. A bus basically means that you have only one wire with the read-write signal, and you have multiple system components that can read or write to from that wire. But then, because you have only one wire, only one of the system components is allowed to drive that wire at a time. The others have to be in a high impedance state, or tri-stated as we say. And the advantage of that is that it saves wires. You use only one wire and you make sure that only one component is driving that wire. The problem I was running into, however, is that now that the CPU is on board, there were spurious memory writes happening across memory boundaries. For instance, the CPU would write something to the video memory in here, so it would pull the read-write bus low, signifying a write, and then it would address the low memory here immediately in the next cycle in order to fetch the next opcode or the next instruction that it has to execute. And what was happening is that the chip select would change from this memory to the low memory, so it would select the low memory, but the bus would still be in a write state, the bus would still be low for a very short amount of time after the chip select was transferred to this memory. And what happened then is that the garbage on the data bus was actually getting written to the low memory, while the intention was that the low memory would only be read from and not written to, because that this is where the kernel, where the code is that the CPU is executing. So to avoid this kind of timing issue, which is mainly because of the breadboard, the moment we go to a PCB, those would probably disappear. But you know, I have spacer, which has 84 pins. So what I figured was, no, it solves one problem and also gives me more flexibility to, instead of using control buses, like read-write bus, chip select bus, whatever, not chip select cannot be a bus, but anyway, instead of using buses, I gave each control signal that goes in or comes out from each of the memories or each of the CPUs or even CAT, I gave each one of these signals a pin on spacer. I had the pins available. So now there is no bus. Now there is just spacer, which is a sort of control nexus. All the control signals go into spacer and come out of spacer. And this gives us maximum flexibility because spacer is a CPLD. It can be reconfigured. So if we are unhappy with the architecture of Cerberus, even after the PCB is final and done, and you guys are already playing with it, we can still change the core of the functionality by reconfiguring spacer. It's a CPLD after all. So I decided to get rid of the control bus. Now I only have the data bus and the address bus, these two here, which turn into these two and these two there. But for the control, I basically have a control nexus, which is spacer, for maximum flexibility. And what this allows me to do, for instance, is that the low memory has one read-write signal, the high memory has another, the video memory has another, the character memory another. So there will never be this spurious writes from one memory to another because of the use of the bus. Because the low memory will only be written to when the read-write signal of the low memory is pulled down, regardless of the state of the read-write signal of the video memory, for instance. So you eliminate this cross-chip crosstalk, this interference, this spurious writes across chips. What you don't do, however, you don't prevent a spurious write to the wrong position of the same chip. That you don't, because the parasitics can make some of the address lines, for instance, have ambiguous levels, not quite zero and not quite one, and then you could get a situation where one write ends up being written to two positions of the memory, because one of the address lines is in an ambiguous state. This is still happening. I don't think it's, well, if it is at all possible, it's not really practical for the parameters of a hobby job, hobby project like this, to get rid of this in the breadboard already. And neither do I need to. I'm going to a custom PCB next anyway. So I accept that there is this noise in the system now. You may see it. I will record some footage of my using Cerberus and testing, running a program in the CPU later on in this episode. So we will see whether there will be this garbage on the screen or not. There is a little bit, almost always, but it's working well enough that I know the logic is right, the kernel code is right, and this is what's important. Now, whatever I did here, I can do for the Zilog, although it's not the same CPU. A Zilog Z80 is significantly more complex than a 6502, which partly explains the popularity of the 6502. The Z80 has a lot more instructions, more complex instructions. It runs at a faster clock speed, but the instructions require more cycles to complete. A memory read will take 3 cycles, while depending on the address mode, a 6502 can do that in one cycle. But it also runs usually a little slower. So the control signals are different. The Zilog doesn't have a read-write bus. It has a write enable and an output enable, or no, it has a read and a write signal. Sorry, the output enable is the memories here. The Zilog has a write and a read signal, both active low, instead of only one read write. So the logic is interpreted in a slightly different way here by spacer. I already have it implemented in spacer. You don't see the cables because I don't want to increase the parasitics even more than they already are. Okay, and the final update is regarding the video board. We are back to some problems in the video board, my relationship of love and hate with the CPLDs here. Let me tell you what's going on. This board has been working reliably for weeks now, actually a couple of months, since I think end of November or early December. This board has been working quite reliably. The problems I was having in the beginning of the project back in October and November, I didn't have any of those problems anymore for all these weeks. But there was something going wrong here that was not serious enough to stop the project. I didn't even mention it to you before. I know I actually did in one of the initial episodes. I told you that I was suspecting that my monitor seemed to require more than 0.7 volts in the RGB signal. And 0.7 is the maximum value according to the VGA standard. But my monitor seemed to be draining more, expecting more than that. That's why, in addition to the buffer, I added another transistor here as a second buffer in order to, you know, to push that voltage up. And I thought, oh, maybe it's just something I don't understand in a VGA standard. But no, there was an error. What was happening is that the RGB signal was still being sent even during the blanking interval when you have the synchronization pulses. During the blanking interval, there is supposed to be no RGB signal. The RGB line is supposed to be silent, grounded, but it was not. And I may need to explain this to you with a diagram. The problem was that I was not resetting the shift register that pumps out the bit stream coming from the character memory.
Here's what the problem is. We discussed this diagram in the very beginning of the series. We discussed how Skunk, together with Kavya, they work in tandem to fetch video information from the video memory and then character bitmap information from the character memory and eventually get it through the RGB bitstream within the VGA video signal. Now, the way it works is that the character maps within the character memory in here are fetched byte by byte, and each byte is loaded into a shift register within Skunk. Now, this shift register has its own clock, the shift register clock in here, and then as this clock ticks, byte by byte of that, bit by bit of that byte is shifted to the right all the way to the end until the last bit is exposed to the RGB line. So that's how you get 8 bits into the RGB bitstream for every byte in each of the character maps that is pointed to by information in the video memory. That's basically the idea. Now, what was going wrong is the following. The shift register clock is withdrawn during the blanking interval because you don't want to put bits out during the blanking interval. So this clock is withdrawn and it comes back alive once you are in the next line, of the video frame you are displaying, never during the blanking interval. The problem is that suppose the very last bit, in other words, the bit corresponding to the rightmost column on the screen, suppose that bit is a 1. So you will be shifting this 1 all the way until this 1 gets in here. And there will be the 1 there, and that 1 will go in the RGB signal. Suppose this is the very last bit, the rightmost column on the screen. The moment this bit is written, in other words, it goes into the RGB signal, the shift register clock is withdrawn. What will happen then? That 1 will stay there. The 1 will hang in there, and it will be still driving the RGB line during the blanking interval, which is not what it was supposed to do. It will get the monitor all confused. Funny things will happen on the side of the monitor. And actually what happens is that the monitor will start draining a lot of current out through the RGB signal, big current, even the voltages will go down. And that's what I confused with my monitor weirdly seeming to require more than 0.7 volts. It wasn't doing that. It was just behaving in an unpredicted way electrically, because there was this very last one hanging around in the shift register, driving the RGB signal throughout the blinking interval. Now, this was the error. The solution is very simple. We just have to add another reset line or reset product term to reset this shift register clock, put all zeros inside the moment we reach the beginning of the blinking interval. And then we make sure that this last bit here will be a zero throughout the blinking interval, which is how it's supposed to be.
And I was not seeing this problem all the time, because as you see in the main window of a Cerberus, the rightmost column of pixels is always black, because I'm using a border character there that doesn't have any activated pixel in the rightmost column. So the shift register always had zero loaded in it in the last cycle before the blanking interval. So it was as if it was reset. But the moment I would put active pixels on the rightmost column, I would get this continuous RGB signal, which was actually harmful for the hardware.
This is the small change that was necessary in the hardware description of Skunk. I've added this three lines. This is basically an extra product term for the asynchronous reset logic of the shift register that puts out the bitstream to the RGB pin of the VGA connector. Before, we just had this term here, the control signal reset, which is a global reset signal for Skunk. Now we added this other term through an OR, so the shift register will asynchronously reset if the reset signal is high, or if this second term here holds. And if you look at this second term, these are the different bits of the horizontal counter. That's what the H means. This is the horizontal counter, which has 11 bits, if I remember correctly. Or 10 maybe. And what this is doing, it's saying, okay, if bit 9 of the horizontal counter is 1, and bit 8 of the horizontal counter is 0, because it's inverted, and bit 7 is 1, and bit 6 of the horizontal counter is 0, and so on and so forth. And if you compute what this number is, this is basically the very beginning of the blanking interval, when the system is moving from writing a horizontal line and going into the blanking interval, which will have then the horizontal sync pulse. So right before the blanking interval begins, this number, this term, will hold, it will be true, and therefore the shift register will be asynchronously reset, and that will prevent that the shift register will keep a 1 hanging from the RGB line during the blinking interval. So it's a very simple change, but it solved what actually was a lurking but serious problem that I just didn't see before, because I didn't do things in a way that would expose this problem. But now it's corrected, so it should be completely fine now. I'll give you now an update, a more detailed update about what has changed in the spacer hardware description. I keep making improvements to that custom chip, but it will make it easier for you to follow along if we briefly review again an update I gave you in the last episode about the pinout of CAT. So this is CAT. This is the microcontroller, one of the three heads of Cerberus. We've discussed before, many pins in CAT go to spacer, because spacer is the sort of serial to parallel bridge for CAT to talk to the rest of the system via the parallel buses, the data bus and the address bus, including talking to the memories. From last week, there is one change. I think I had a data output enable signal here that would tell spacer when to enable the output of its data bus. But I concluded, it's pretty clear, this signal is completely redundant, because we already have the read-write signal here. And when the read-write signal is zero, it means a write, and only in those situations will we want to enable the data output. So we don't read DOE because we already had the RW signal in there. Now, what I want to discuss again now to briefly remind you of what's going on are these four signals here. And these are the four signal lines that CAT uses through spacer in order to control the two CPUs. So remember, CAT, the Atmega 328, is the system master. The CPUs are the slaves. So CAT uses these four signals here to control the CPUs on the other side of spacer. Now, these signals are CPU reset, which is active low. Actually, it's not. I've implemented it as active high for now. So this is an inconsistency between this slide and what you will see in the hardware description. CPU reset basically means that when this signal is asserted by CAT, the whatever CPU is chosen as the CPU that the user is running, that CPU will be reset. CPU go, when this signal is high, the CPU is enabled and can use the buses. But when this signal is low, then it's a no-go for the CPU. The CPU will be halted and its buses will be brought into a high impedance state. The CPU will not be reset by CPU go. It will be reset only by CPU reset. And the idea here is that CAT can play with CPU go to start and pause the CPU. But when it starts again, it doesn't start from zero, from a reset state. It will start from where it left off. And this is very important in order to communicate with the CPUs without, you know, screwing up the program counter of the CPUs. So CPU go basically pauses or lets the CPU go. CPU IRQ is just to signal to the CPU through spacer. Everything is through spacer. When the CPU should go and have a look at the mailbox because the user has typed something on the keyboard, and the CPU should go have a look. So when that's the case, CAT will assert this signal, and that will tell the CPU, you know, stop what you're doing and go have a look at the mailbox. And CPU select basically tells spacer which CPU is the chosen one now. Is it the 6502 or is it the Z80? As you see, this signal is important to keep all the control signals neatly independent from one another. And it is CAT that will know via a command the user will type on the edit line which CPU is the CPU that's chosen at that moment in time. So you will see these four signals, which are outputs of CAT but inputs to spacer. You will see all four of them being used in the logic equations of spacer. So this is what we are going to look at now: the logic equations that define the hardware of spacer and how those equations use these four signals here. And this is the update of the hardware description of spacer. I'm not going to go over all the pin descriptions with you. I'll explain them once we encounter them in the logic. This first part you've seen before is just to make sure that spacer doesn't get a clock until it's fully powered on, because again, these CPLDs are finicky when it comes to power on reset. You have to meet all kinds of tricky conditions, and this is one of the strategies to meet those conditions. And then we have the CPU control logic. For now, I only have the 6502 signals. There will be three or four extra signals for the Z80, entirely equivalent to what you see here. So for instance, this is the bus enable of the 6502. When this signal is pulled low, the 6502 will tri-state its address and control bus. In other words, it will bring its buses to a high impedance state, allowing CAT to control the buses and access memory. So under which conditions will the bus enable hold? In other words, the 6502 will have its buses enabled. Well, it will be when the 6502 is selected, which happens when CPU selection is zero. That's why it's inverted. So when the 6502 is selected and when the CPU go signal is asserted, then the 6502 will have its buses enabled. CPU go is an output of CAT 2 spacer. Similar logic here for the ready signal or the RDY if the 6502 is selected. And we are in CPU go mode, then the 6502 will not be halted. When this signal here is not asserted, when it's low, this will effectively halt the 6502. This signal is redundant because I'm also withdrawing the clock, so the 6502 would be halted anyway. But since I have the pins in the space, I rather use the redundancy for didactical purposes. This is the IRQ signal for the 6502. In fact, I'm using the non-maskable interrupt. So this should be NMI, non-maskable interrupt. I'm keeping the IRQ here because it's used as if it were a normal interrupt. The reason I'm using NMI is that it's edge triggered. In other words, when this signal here, which is connected to the NMI input of the 6502, when it goes over a high to low transition, it will immediately trigger an interrupt. If you use the normal IRQ pin of the 6502, then there is a protocol that has to be observed. The 6502 will tell the component that issued the interrupt when it can let go of the interrupt signal, when the interrupt is already served. And this is all very nice and well, but it's much simpler to use NMI. And there is no reason not to use it, because you see, NMI was made, or the normal IRQ signal was made to be maskable, because in some, you know, industrial control applications, you have time critical functions that need to be performed on time. So the processor will mask its own interrupts because it cannot be interrupted in those time critical functions. But in this case, you know, this is a didactical platform. It will not be doing any industrial control or controlling airplane engines or anything like this. So it's perfectly fine to use the non-maskable interrupt, because the reaction time from the user perspective doesn't matter much if you interrupt the processor when it's, you know, executing a game. If you forcibly interrupt it, well, you just get a key entry. You will not notice any delay or anything, because these things happen so fast from a human perspective, and it simplifies the whole hardware if I use the NMI. So ultimately, I chose to use NMI in the case of the 6502, and the NMI pin of the 6502 will be connected to this IRQB6502 pin from spacer. And the logic is similar to what you've seen before. If 6502 is selected as the CPU, and CAT is asserting the CPU IRQ pin, which is an output of CAT, an input to spacer, then IRQB will be asserted, but because it's active low, it's inverted. Similar for the reset signal, when the CPU wants to reset, when CAT wants to reset the CPU, it will assert its CPU reset signal, which is an input for spacer. And if that's asserted while the 6502 is the CPU selected, then reset will be asserted and it's active low, so the signal is inverted. Now, this is the chip select logic for the four memories. We've covered this before, I will not repeat it. And this is what's new. And this is basically a huge multiplexer, well, huge, it's not complex at all, but it's a seemingly large multiplexer circuit that replaces the control bus. And it splits all the signals, so there is no crosstalk between the signals meant for one memory and those meant for another memory. So what you see here, for instance, is the read-write signal for the video memory, the read-write signal for the character memory, the write-enable signal for the high memory, the write enable signal for the low memory, the output enable signal for the high memory, and so on and so forth. And what you see is that, for instance, read write, it's a write if it's low. So what this logic here is doing is, if any of these three system components, CAT, the 6502, or the Z80, if any one of them is asserting a write, in other words, their signal is low, so that's why you have an inverter here, then the result should be a write. And because a write is active low, there is an inverter here. But the critical thing is, I'm adding this term. So the read-write signal for the video memory will only be asserted when the chip enable of the video memory is also asserted. So when the read-write signal is meant for another memory, we will not get any confusion here because of this added term, which separates the control bus signals on a component-by-component basis. If read-write is asserted for the character memory, then it will be asserted here, but this term here will prevent it from that read-write meant for the character memory will prevent it from impacting the video memory, because they are separated by this final term. And these are the output enables. They are slightly different, because in this case it's the read that counts, and the read is high, so we don't invert the read-write signal from the two CPUs, but we still do invert the read signal from the Z80. Remember, the Z80 doesn't have a read-write, it has a read and a write, and both are active low. So in this case, the Z80 is asserting a read when RD is low, so we have to invert it in here for the equation to work, because output enable is active low as well. So this is basically it. It's very simple to understand the logic behind here. The important point is the very final term in each equation, which splits out that signal from a bus-like approach to a sort of nexus or multiplexer-like approach, in which you cannot get confusion between the signals meant for different chips. Now, the clock management logic is the same as you saw before. This signal pause here is asserted when one of the dual-ported memories is signaling that it's busy, that there is a conflict in the addressing across the two sides of the memory. We've discussed this before. But now we need to create this term any write, because now if any of the three processors of Cerberus, the three-headed dog, if any of the three processors is trying to do a write, and that's why we have this inversion, because write is active low, then any write will be asserted and used here. So what this means is that if we are selecting either the dual-ported video memory or the dual-ported character memory, and somebody in the system is trying to write to those dual-ported memories, and the dual-ported memory is issuing a BZ, which is active low, as a response, then we should pause the clock for the conflict to resolve itself. Now, this is the clock divider. We had four states here before. Now we only have two, and the reason is I'm only dividing the clock from 16 megahertz to 4. So to do that, we only need these two states of a counter, and that's what we get here. The CPU clock is given by this equation, which basically means, oops, what have I done? Which basically means the clock will be state C1 of the counter, which basically means it's 4 megahertz instead of 16, and CPU has to be a go. When cat deasserts CPU go and makes it low, then the CPU has to stop, because cat wants control again, wants to use the buses and access the memories again. So this CPU go signal will go low, and because it's ended, then the CPU clock will disappear. It will be just low. And it should also go, should also stop when there is pause. Sorry, this equation basically means the clock goes on if there isn't a pause. If there is a pause, then the inverter here will make it zero, and whatever you end with zero is zero, so the CPU clock line will go zero. There will be no clock. Similar approach for the cat clock, except that we are getting the full 16 megahertz, not a state of the clock divider. And now we make it specific for cat. If there is pause asserted, in other words, there is a conflict in writing to the dual-ported memories and we need to wait, then the cat clock will be withdrawn only if it is cat who is trying to write. Cat will not stop if it's the CPUs trying to write, because cat still has to serve the IOs. So a user could be entering a key press while you have a pause state because a CPU is accessing memory. So we don't want to stop cat because the CPU is accessing memory. That's why we have this term here to make it very specific for cat. The clock of cat will only be stopped if it is cat that's trying to write and you get a pause in return. Now the rest is the same as you've seen before. I'm not going to cover the shift register logic again. It's just the same as you've seen before. And here's the updated Arduino sketch that is serving as our kernel code. There are some changes in the pins. I realized that I could do away with a pin that before I had declared here, which was the data output enable. I actually don't need that because it's redundant with read-write. We only want to enable the data output of spacer, which is connected to CAT, when we are trying to write. So we already have the read-write signal there, so the DOE was redundant, I removed it. There are some pins added, most of this I covered before, I'm not going to repeat what I already covered, I only show you some changes. And this is one important change. Now, if the CPU is running, which is determined by this global variable here, CPU running, which is a boolean, it's either true or false. If it's true, if the CPU is running, then the effect of the user pressing the ESC key or escape is given by these lines of code here. Basically what it would do is, it will write out the CPU go pin with a low. In other words, the CPU go pin of CAT will go low. And that would tell spacer that it should pause the CPU that is running right now, either the 6502 or the Z80. Spacer will do that in two different and redundant ways. It will pull the RDY or ready signal low, and it will withdraw the clock. So the CPU will really halt when CPU go is asserted, which is what happens here. If the user presses ask, we want to halt the CPU, and this will do that. There's a little delay here just to make sure that the CPU has time to react. This is 1 millisecond. It's a huge amount of time, I don't know, over 10 clock cycles. But in terms of human response time, you will not even sense this passing. So it, we can afford to be very conservative here. Then we will say that CPU is no longer running, and by attributing false to this global variable here, CPU running, we will clear the entire screen, and we will reprint the frames, the status line, and we will clear the edit line, giving that screen that we are familiar with already for Cerberus, which lets the user know that, okay, there is a command line available now, we can type in commands. So that's what happens when the CPU is running and the user presses ESC or escape. It will halt the CPU and return the command prompt to the user. Now, there are some other changes. For instance, all the other key responses, like up arrow, they are conditioned to the CPU not being running, because these are the keys you use to type in commands, and you will not be typing in commands when the CPU is running, an application is running. The only thing that will be enabled when the application is running is what you see here. So this is the final else, so there's no special key pressed. The user just pressed a letter or a number. If the CPU is not running, then this will just update the edit line, like you typed the next letter of a command that you're writing on the edit line. But else, in other words, if the CPU is running, then this is what you will do. CAT will interpret that key press as an input to the code running in the CPU. Like if the CPU is running a game and you need to tell that game whether you want to move your spaceship high or low, to the left or right, or fire, you need to be able to pass on a key press to the CPU, and this is what this little code here will do. It will first halt the CPU, like before, giving a little delay of 1 millisecond for good measure. Then, after the CPU is halted and the buses are again available to CAT, because remember, part of halting the CPU is disabling the CPU's buses, putting them in a high impedance state. The moment that happens, CAT has access to the buses and the memories again, so it will just write into the mailbox, which is address hexadecimal 200, the ASCII code of the key the user has just pressed. And then it will set the CPU loose again by setting CPU go as high. So the clock will return, the buses will return, and the CPU will be able to continue executing code. And we wait for 1 millisecond, which will allow the CPU to execute a handful of instructions. And then we will interrupt the CPU by pulling CPU IRQ high and then low again. And the effect will be that the 6502 in this case will receive an unmaskable interrupt, which will be announcing to the CPU that in the mailbox, in address 200, there is an ASCII code corresponding to a key the user has pressed. So the CPU can load the contents of that address, for instance, in the accumulator, and react accordingly depending on the game logic or the program logic that has been programmed. So this is basically what happens there. This part you've seen, except that we have some new commands, not only Django and CLS anymore. Now we have test mem, which I will show you what it does. It basically reads and writes to all the memories to test them. We have test CPU, which is a built-in very small assembly program that exercises the communication protocol between CAT and the CPU. I will show that to you later on. We can change mode. So if we type 6502, we will select the 6502 CPU by setting CPU select low. This will tell Spacer that we are now in 6502 mode. Or we can press Z80 and then we will assert CPU select high, which will tell Spacer, well, it's the Z80 that is now going to be the CPU. This is a new command, peek, which basically allows us to see the contents of memory. I will explain this below when I show you this function. This part only calls the function peek. I'll show you the function peek shortly. There is a poke as well, which, as the name suggests, writes something to an address in memory. That's the function call. I'll show you the function in a moment. Load image we've seen before. Get next word we saw before. I transfer the load image logic to a separate function, which you see here, but we've discussed all this before. All this stuff we've discussed before. That's the jingle. Now, I will not tell you what this is right now. It's just an internal function which translates a video address from a virtual space to a real space. And the reason is we have these frames around the screen, sort of a little box framed. And that means that the first row and the last row and the first column and then the last column should not be changed because they are the frame. So whatever the user program or whatever the kernel code does, it should not change those addresses. But the effect is that the addresses in the video memory that you can change are no longer in a sequence. There are interruptions in that sequence to take into account the characters of the framing, the wireframe. So this will just implement some logic that allows you to pretend that the video addresses the kernel can write to, in fact, are sequential, when they are not. It will just translate a sequential virtual address space to a real but non-sequential address space. It's just for convenience. So this is the test memory function that I just mentioned earlier. It will apply a number of pokes and peaks. Which basically write a variety of characters and then read what it has just written to every single memory in the system. It will write to the low memory and read from the low memory and then write that to the high memory and read from the high memory and so on and so forth. And address translate is used here because by using this function, which I just discussed here on top, we can pretend that the video addresses are sequential when they in fact are not. So this tests all the memories. And this is the CPU test, which I'll show you live running, but just to give you an idea of what's happening. If the mode is false, in other words, if it's a 6502, then this is the logic that will be done. And this basically is a series of pokes to addresses in memory. So these first two pokes to addresses FFFA and FFFB are basically the interrupt vector. When the 6502 receives an interrupt from CAT, it will reply to that interrupt by executing some code in memory. And what these two bytes will tell is where that code is in memory, where the code is of the interrupt handling routine that needs to be executed upon an interruption. And that will be in address 201. Remember, the 6502 is a little Indian machine, so the least significant byte is stored in the lower address and the most significant in the higher address. Now, what we will find there in address 0201, it will be one byte, byte 40, and that corresponds to one instruction, RTI, which is return from interrupt. In other words, the interrupt routine basically contains a return from interrupt, and the reason is the mailbox will contain the value of the key that has been pressed. So very little management is needed. This is just to tell the CPU there is something in the mailbox. You don't need to take any special action. Just go look at the mailbox. That's basically what this means. And this is the reset vector, which will contain the code of the address to which the processor will look to find the first execution, the first instruction to execute upon being reset. And that address will be 2000 or X2000. That's the beginning of the code area. So when the CPU is reset, it will come to the reset vector, read this address 2000, and then go to the address and load an opcode from that address, which will correspond to the first instruction that needs to be executed after the reset. Now, what will we find there in address 2000? It's here. This series of bytes from address 2000 to 2001, 2002, all the way down to 2011 in X, each one of them will contain a byte. And the collection of these bytes is the program that the CPU will execute upon being reset or just after reset. And here I put in a comment in more readable terms what that program is. This is the assembly code and this is the machine code. So what this basically will do is it will load register X with a zero, then it will wait for an interrupt. When the interrupt arrives, what will it do? It will go to the interrupt vector and there it will find instruction 40, which is return from interrupt. So this way here, or wait for interrupt, it will just make the CPU wait until the user presses a key. Once the user has pressed the key, cat will interrupt the CPU and then the CPU will go to the next instruction, which is load the accumulator with this value here, 200. In X. And what is in that address 200? And this is an address, and it will load the accumulator with the contents of address 200 in memory. And what is that address? That's the mailbox, where cat will have put the ASCII code of the key that has just been pressed. So what this will do, it will load internal register accumulator of the CPU with the contents of the mailbox, which is the key the user has pressed. And then it will store the contents of that accumulator in address F9ED plus the value of the register X. But register X starts at zero, so in the first loop, first pass of the loop, we can ignore this. It will just store the contents of address 200 in address F9ED, which is an address in the video memory. In other words, this store A, store accumulator, will just print on the screen the letter that the user has pressed on the keyboard. And then it will increment register X. So now instead of being 0, it will be 1 here. Then it will compare X to 10, more than 10, this is 16, or in X, 0F. Yeah, 15 actually. 16 if you count from 0, this is 15. It will compare the contents of register X with this, and it will branch on not equal. In other words, if we haven't reached 0F yet, we will branch back to P2, which is wait again for the next interrupt. In other words, wait for the next key press. And once the key has been pressed and cat interrupts the CPU, then the CPU will load the contents of the mailbox in the accumulator, store the accumulator into register F9ED plus the contents of X, which will now be 1, and later on 2, 3, 4, in other words, the next position on the screen, so you don't write one letter on top of the previous letter, and so on, until we write 15 letters on the screen. And at that point, now it will be equal, so we will not branch, we'll go to the next instruction, which is a jump back to P1, which loads X with 0 again. In other words, it goes back to the beginning of the text line and the whole process repeats. So this is basically a little typewriter program, a super simple text editor with 15 positions per line and only one line. But it exercises everything that is important about the communication and control protocol between CAT and the 6502. because the 65O2 goes to its reset vector, it executes instructions on its own, it also waits for an interrupt, and when the interrupt comes, it handles that interrupt. So all the communication between CAT and CPU is exercised through this very, very small, very, very minimal, simple code, which occupies little space in the kernel memory, and that's very important. Since I'm having some space problems in the kernel memory. And it's basically here, the same program written in memory via these pokes. CPoke stands for Cerberus poke, which is the internal command, and poke without C is the command the user can type in the edit line. That's basically the convention. Now, once this code is in memory, we will say to the rest of the kernel, okay, a CPU will now be running. So CPU running is true. Then we will write to the CPU reset pin of CAT, which is connected to spacer. We will make that high, signaling to spacer, you should reset the CPU. We will make CPU go high, which will tell spacer, release the clock and assert the ready signal and the bus enable signals of the CPU, so the CPU can access the buses, access memory, and has a clock to tick on. Then we wait 10 milliseconds, which is a huge amount of time for a CPU, but in terms of reaction time, the user will not even notice that anything is happening there, so we can be conservative. And finally, we will pull the reset line down. So this delay here is just to make sure that the reset pin is asserted long enough for the reset to be registered. Then we let it low again, so the CPU will come out of the reset state, and what will it do? It will go to its reset vector, which is at these addresses here, FFFC and FFFD. And what will it find there? It will find another address, address 2000, which is the beginning of the code area. And then it will fetch the first opcode to execute in address 2000. And what opcode will it be? It will be A2. And A2 corresponds to the load X instruction, which requires an operand, and that operand is 00. And this 00 will be the next byte. And after it has done that, it will go to the next opcode, which is the wait for interrupt opcode, CB. That's what it will find in the next address. And so on and so forth. After that, it will execute AD, which is the opcode for load A, with the contents of a certain address. So you have AD to identify that it's a load A instruction. And then we have the two bytes corresponding to the address that whose contents should be loaded into the accumulator, and so on and so forth. This is basically how this works. Now, last thing. This is the poke instruction. This is not CPoke, this is poke. So this is what will happen when the user types poke in the edit line. It receives two strings as operands, an address and a value. Of course, the first thing we need to do is to translate those text strings into numbers, an actual hexadecimal address and an actual hexadecimal value. This is what these two lines do. And then it will just perform a CPoke, an actual poke, inserting that value on that address, which have been calculated here as numbers. And then it will give you feedback on the screen saying which address has been poked, and then it will use a CPeak to confirm that the poke command was correctly executed, so the user sees if the memory address the user wanted to write into, if that address now contains the value the user actually wanted to be there. So this is just visual feedback to reassure the user the command poke has been executed. And the peak is in here. It requires only one argument, which is the start address. And from the start address, it will print as many addresses, the contents of as many addresses as fits in the screen for convenience. And the logic is similar. Address 1 will just have to convert that start string into an actual number stored in address 1. Then we will check if address 1 is lower than this, because this number plus the number of addresses that fit on the screen is the maximum address. If you type an address 1 that is higher than that, like four addresses before the end, then you cannot fill the screen. And then in that case, we will set address 2 as the last address that we can read from. And it will perform this loop showing the contents of each of the addresses in question. So there is this index I, which starts from address 1 and ends in address 2, and it gets incremented every pass in the loop. and then we would do just a CPIC for that address three times, because we want to show that in decimal, in X, and the corresponding ASCII code. That's basically it. This is the kernel code. What we need to do now is to implement a bare bones, well, not a bare bones, actually a glorified machine code monitor, but not an assembler. It will not fit. If I click here on compile, I'll show you how much of the memory we are using. This warning here can be ignored, it's inconsequential. But look, we are already at 60% of the code memory, which is okay, there's still space for a lot of code, but 68% of the dynamic memory, which is only 2 kilobytes, and this is the bottleneck. The more code we write, the more global variables and local variables, so the more dynamic memory will be needed. And when this passes 75%, the system can become unstable. So there is little space left. That's why I will have to content myself with a glorified machine code monitor built into the kernel, as opposed to a full assembler. Although a full assembler can still be implemented as a program in one of the CPUs through a binary file. But I wanted the kernel to not depend on any system file in the SD card or the micro SD card. I wanted it to be self-contained. So this is what you see here. What you see here is the self-contained part. That's why this little CPU test program in assembly, I'm not using a load file from the SD card to read this file in. Which would allow me to make a much more complex CPU test program, but you can always do that in a system file in the SD card. But I wanted to have a bare bones CPU test built into the kernel itself, so it would work even in the absence of an SD card in the system, just like the old computers used to be, not like the modern computers that need to boot from some mass storage device. I wanted this to have still functionality even in the absence of a mass storage device. That's why I kept this code very simple and built into the kernel itself, as opposed to an external file.
So if I connect the programmer here for cat, the system will reset itself, and I want you to see what happens when it starts up. It gives that little message saying it's initializing, and then gives you the prompt. The commands you've seen before, they are still there. For instance, I can load an image from file, an image here from this micro SD card, and display it on the screen like you've seen before. I can clear the screen. I can play the little jingle again at will. I've implemented also some more practical commands, such as peek. If I peek hexadecimal 2000, that's the beginning of the code area in the low memory, and it will display the contents of that code area. Right now, you see they are all zero, but the program will be loaded in there. The program we will run on the 6502 in here. And then if you peek again, you see that that's populated there. There are more useful peeks, like I can peek the beginning of the video area, and it will not be surprising what you see there. You see, this is the character represented by hexadecimal 85 or decimal 133, which is the content of address F800. Now, what is that address? It is this character here, this border character, which is what you see there. And then the address after that, F801, it's the decimal 3, which is hexadecimal 3, and it's this character here, the horizontal character, which is here. And all the next ones are the same because it corresponds to this line. So peek will give you for each address in a sequence of about 24 addresses, starting from the address you type in, it will tell you the contents of that address in decimal, hexadecimal, and it will give you the character that is represented by the corresponding ASCII value, which can be useful when you are peeking the memory area, for instance. Now I can go, and I implemented also a test memory function in the kernel. These test functions, I don't want them to depend on binary files here in the SD card, because they are supposed to be, you know, your last line of defense to test the system in a bare bones state. So this test memory function is implemented in the kernel inside cat, and not on the disk. And then what it will do, Okay, it's not working, and the reason it's not working is that I didn't reconnect the cable. I have to reconnect this cable, otherwise the memory will not be accessible for reading and writing. And you will get that that's an error, that the character you see there is ASCII code 0, which is the cursor character, the little strong man with a C in the chest. So let me reconnect this. Okay, it's reconnected. It was supposed to connect here pin 25 of spacer. That cable is the write enable of the low memory. It should work now, so let's do test mem. Again, this is a kernel function. It's not a binary in the SD card. And what it will do, it will write a series of character tokens or byte values corresponding to different characters. It will write that list in the low memory, then it will read from the low memory and write what it has just read into the high memory, then it will read from the high memory and write what it has just read to the video memory, and based on the contents of the video memory, Skunk will receive the corresponding bitmap for that character from the character memory here. So this one function, although it just fills the screen with different characters in the character set, it's basically testing all four memories, or three of them for reads and writes, and one of them for reads, and the last one being the character memory. So you get a pretty good idea of whether the memory system is working by just typing in this kernel built command. This also gives you an idea of the character set, the default character set. Cerberus will have a programmable character set that can be changed even during program execution, but I put some characters there on the default, like the little ghost of Pac-Man, the Pac-Man guys, a little Space Invaders ghost, Galactica spaceship, a few other characters to represent different stages of an explosion. In other words, and some arrows, little house. I put stuff there that I thought could be useful, because this is an educational platform, and what people will use it for is to write demos and games, to get acquainted with computer engineering and low-level software programming. So I try to help by adding already this pre-built character setting there. What we haven't seen yet is the CPU test, and there is a built-in function as well. It's a very short program, but it proves, one, that the CPU is executing code. In other words, that cat is doing a handover of control to the CPU correctly, that the CPU can be halted by cat whenever cat wants, and then allowed to continue from the point where it halted seamlessly after cat allows it to continue. And it also shows that cat can communicate data with the CPU via the mailbox here in address X200 in the low memory. All of this is proven by this very simple application, which is basically a typewriter application with up to 15 characters. It's small like this, again, because I want it to be in the kernel code and not a binary program in the SD card. And all it does is it prints on the screen the letters I type, like Q, W, E, R, T, Y. So you see, this is not cat doing it, huh? It's the 6502 being interrupted by cat, reading the ASCII character that cat has left in the mailbox in the low memory, loading the accumulator with that character, and then storing it in a memory address corresponding to the video memory, and that's the result. You just see it in there. Now, I can write something more significant. Like the byte attic. So it, and if I continue to type, it will just wrap around and wrap around those 15 values for any character I type in. Now, stupid simple, you may say. If I type in spaces, it will just clear the screen. So you may say, well, this is stupid. I wrote it in the wrong position. Then you may say, you know, this is stupid simple. So why did you bother? Well, because this very simple program exercises all the critical control functions, the control transfer between CAT and the 6502, the interrupt system for communication between the two, the halt and reset, because when you type test CPU, the CPU is actually reset. It exercises all that for, I don't know, six, seven, eight maybe assembly instructions. I think it's eight assembly instructions. So it hardly takes any space here in the kernel memory inside CAT. And it allows you to exercise all that. That's why I chose this very simple application. It's a great trade-off between memory space, which I'm running low of, and the functionality that covers everything that is important. Now, once you've run your CPU program and you want to go back to the normal prompt of a Cerberus, you just press ESC for escape, and it will bring you back. And now if we peek in the code area of the memory, which is also here in the low memory, we will see the program. That's the program. It's you see more bytes than instructions, because some instructions now require immediate operands and stuff and addresses. I think it's seven or eight instructions, but these are all the bytes. These bytes here, from address 2000x to address 2011x. And the last byte is just a stop. So it's not even functional, it's just to prevent the CPU from continuing to try to execute whatever garbage may be left in memory. So it's good practice to end with a stop. But it's that simple. It's that simple code. Now, I also have a poke implemented. So for instance, if I go to this address here that I told you is relevant, 2011x, which has the byte DB. So if I go there, 2011, and say I will put a zero in there instead of DB. So it will tell me that, okay, you've put a zero in there. So if we peek again from 2000 on, there is a zero now there instead of DB. But if I again run test CPU, and whatever I put in there, and I go back and peek again, DB is back. So that's basically it. You have a few commands implemented in the kernel. I still need more. I need, for instance, a bulk move command to move entire areas of code from one part of memory to another part of memory. I need to implement that. I will implement a glorified machine code monitor. I do not have spacer in CAT to implement an assembler, because I'm already almost at 70% memory usage for variables and 60 odd percent for code memory. And when I cross 75%, the programming environment starts telling me that I'm using too much memory and the code may become unstable. So it's not reliable to go above 75% code usage. I'm already very close to it for the global variables. So I certainly don't have space for an assembler, and that may surprise you, because you may think, you know, you have 32 kilobytes in here, man, and then the old computers, they could put an entire basic interpreter in 8 kilobytes, like the ZX81. Oops, I pulled the cable again, but I remember what it is. There you go. So what are you talking about? You're running out of code. Well, you know, you're not comparing apples to apples if you do this comparison, because this is a RISC processor, a reduced instruction set computer, while these two guys here, the 6502 and the Z80, they are CISC. So to do the job of one instruction in the Z80, for instance, you will need several RISC instructions for this little processor inside CAT. And that occupies a lot more code memory, because RISC is a trade-off. The processor becomes simpler and cheaper and even faster in terms of clock speed. But the price is that your code size explodes. This was the biggest challenge, for instance, ARM had in the 90s when they were initially adopted by mobile phones, by Nokia. They had to prove to Nokia that despite having a RISC processor, they could keep code density under control. That's why they developed the ARM thumb instruction set, which is still used today in every mobile phone, in every iPad, whatever mobile devices you have. It was precisely to address this. So 32 kilobytes for all kernel code in a RISC processor is very, very little. And I'm running out of it. So there will be no fully full-fledged assembler built into the kernel, but there will be a very decent machine code monitor with some bells and whistles, some commands implemented for convenience, but you will have to type in the bytes corresponding to each opcode and address in a convenient way, but you have to know the values. And of course, later on, once I release this tool, I will look into the possibility of porting some existing assembler targeting the Z80 and the 6502, but more importantly, already running on a Z80 and or a 6502 to port it, so then Cerberus would have an assembler, or will have an assembler, but the assembler will be running as a normal application in one of the CPUs and not as part of CAT's kernel code. Now, I could wait until I've done that before releasing this project to the public, but I will not, because I suspect that there are people out there who will very, very gladly do this porting work. And if they have a machine code monitor, a good one to begin with, that's all they need. So I'm going to release Cerberus as soon as I have the final board, not a prototype one, but the final board and the kernel with the machine code monitor. Maybe a couple of examples of applications running on the CPUs. I don't know, a game for each CPU, but not an assembler, not a basic interpreter. I will let the community do that. And if the community doesn't do it, then I may eventually do it myself for the heck of it. But I'm not going to hold back Cerberus until I have that before I release it. I will release it just after the monitor is done.
And that release is not too far off. Since I have decided, it is official now, I will go for a full system prototype PCB, not a partial one. I will go for the whole shebang and see how far we can get. I'll try to make an episode dedicated to the board design, so stay tuned for the next episode on that. And until then, stay safe, and I will see you in the next episode. Ta-da!